585. Announcements this morning. We got revival coming up this evening, so don't forget that. With Clint White, he'll be here. Of course, there'll be no Bible study Wednesday because revival will go through Wednesday night. Covered dish supper on April the 9th, following the service. April the 9th at 6 p.m. the service to follow. Okay, and of course that's the night, right?
Right.
About to get it mixed up in the rest of us that Monday night. The singing tonight that was supposed to be, we won't have our singers. We're gonna have one song, somebody, and then the choir and regular music
tonight.
Yeah.
We will have choir special, and then the kids are gonna do something.
Okay, kids are gonna do something. All right. So we'll get that straight. Rest of it's in there. Easter egg hunt Sunday, April the 6th. Sunrise service at 6:45. Sunday school, 9:45. Youth theme park. And Marlboro has asked us to announce they come and support us on some of our fundraisers. They got a dinner Saturday, July the 1st, 6 to 7. $15 each tickets to eat, but they got pork tenderloin and beans. I'll post this in the back so that you'll have that to look at if you'd like to go support them. And that's July the 1st, 6 to 7. Any other announcements? Anything I missed? If not, Christ is risen. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and we pray for those who've come. We pray for the needs that they have. We pray that hearts would be touched and in some way, Lord, that you know that they need to be touched this day by words or by fellowship or by something that's said. Lord, we pray for those who are not here, who are unable to be here, that are providentially hindered for whatever reason. Lord, we pray for them this morning for their needs as well. Father, we pray for the upcoming revival. We pray that you would bless us in this revival, that we would indeed be revived, Lord. We pray for Clint, that you would keep him safe as he travels back and forth, Lord, and you'd watch over him and that we would just have a good revival that would revive us, Lord. Lord, we pray this morning for this service. We pray for the remainder of this service. We pray that the things we do and say here will be in accordance with your will and keeping with your word. We pray for the outpouring of your Holy Spirit. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Take our hymnals this morning and turn to number 277. 277.
Sydney.
Amen. Amen. Take a moment while they're getting down and take a look at our prayer list this morning. We took the Watson Howell family off, I believe. Is that right, Bet?
Weston,
I'm sorry, yeah. Off this morning. We added Fran Huggins. Hutchison. Fran Hutchison. Okay, I don't hear good over there. Right. Yeah, Carl Leinberger also, we added him to this morning. He has cancer to our prayer list. Are there others that we can take off or that we need to add to our prayer list this morning?
Claude, if you would add Larry Harrison.
Larry Harrison, okay.
He's had back surgery.
Back surgery, okay.
And Buddy Sasser called one night and said that he was doing good. He wasn't sick. The only thing, he's losing his hair.
Yeah.
He wasn't with the group right now.
Yeah, right.
But he was hoping he could be back with them by the front of the year so he could come out here and get some more good food.
Maybe so. Hope so. Yeah, some chemo loses your hair and some lose the hair and some don't. I lost some in the first round and then it quit, so I don't know. Well, I was losing mine before too, but I lost a whole bunch right there, that first treatment. Then after that, it didn't anymore come out. I don't know why, but it affects people different ways and different kinds of chemo. Are there any others we need to add to the prayer list this morning or updates? Oh, yeah. Well, Teresa and Baldy are on our prayer list. They've been on there a good while, but Baldy's sprung his knee, but it's in a soft cast. So we need to keep him in our prayers. We keep them on our prayer list, both of them. Any others this morning? Okay, if not, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and we pray for the needs that were lifted up here. We pray for the needs of each one on our prayer list this morning. For each one has different needs, so we pray for those individual needs as you see fit. Father, we pray not only for those on our prayer list, but we pray for the families involved and the caregivers and the doctors with those on our list this morning. We lift them up to you, Lord, and pray for their needs as well. Father, we pray for our country today. We pray for our government, our armed forces. We pray for our president, Lord. We pray for those in our nursing homes and caregivers and homebound, Lord. Unspoken needs, Lord. Our law enforcement, Lord. Our churches at large, Lord. We just pray, Lord, for your intervention, your return this day, Lord. We pray for your Holy Spirit, the outpouring of your Holy Spirit, Lord. There are many other things that are on our minds and prayers, Lord. And if there are needs on the heart of someone has a need here this morning, if they'll lift that need up to you, we pray now for the need that's being lifted up as you're lifting it up. Lord, we lift all these things up to you in Christ's name. Amen. Can we... have our ushers to come forward.
Amen. That was great.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we stand before you with bowed heads and humbled hearts, wanting to give thanks for the many wonderful blessings that you shower upon us each and every day of our lives. Father, we thank you for all blessings, both those large and small. We ask your blessing on the service today. I ask you that you bless the congregation and all the members present. Bless Pastor Claude as he delivers his sermon today. And please accept these blessings. These tithes and offerings given as a part of the many wonderful blessings that you bestow to us. Multiply them, use them for your work, and all with these things we pray. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
And remain standing, if you would, and take your hymnals now and turn to number 288. Thank you.
Today is extra special because it is Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday is the Sunday before what great big holiday?
Easter Sunday.
Right. So, the kids made palm branches today, and on them, what does it say? Ainsley or Skylar? What does it say on
it?
Hosanna. Hosanna to the King of Kings. And we're going to sing a song about that in just a minute, but before we do, I'm going to read you the passage from the Bible about Jesus's triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Listen up. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Not on a horse, like a king of war would come, right? On a donkey. Servant would come, like a humble king. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" Now, Hosanna is a Hebrew expression meaning save. Okay? So these people were looking to Jesus to save, but many of them didn't understand how. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" And the crowd answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Now, guys, I want to tell you something. That same crowd that said, "Hosanna," and praised Jesus when he rode in on Friday, what did they say?
They killed him.
Kill him. That's right. That same crowd that said, "Praise Jesus, Hosanna," those are the ones that shouted, "Crucify him." So guys, I want to tell you, I want to charge you all, let's not be like that crowd. Let's not come to church on Sunday and say, "Hosanna, praise him," and then the rest of the week go do sinful things. Because if we do that, then we're just like that fickle crowd, aren't we? Mm-hmm. We got to be Christians all the time. We got to shout his praises all the time, even when things look sad or when things get hard. Amen? Mm-hmm. Amen. All right, now stand and we're going to sing Hosanna. All right, so give me oil in my lamp. Keep me burning. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning. Give me oil in my lamp, I'll pray. Give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning. Keep me burning till the break of day. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna
Well, Jennifer read most of your scripture this morning that we were going to be preaching on. I chose Matthew. I think she read maybe from Luke. I'm not sure. But Jesus enters the village from Bethpage, and he goes in riding on a donkey. The daughter of Zion, King of Kings, gentle riding on the donkey. The disciples did as they were instructed, and they brought that colt or that donkey to Jesus that had never been ridden, and Jesus rides him into Jerusalem. And the crowds ahead of him shout, "Hosanna, Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Hosanna in the highest." And when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" That's the crux of it. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth." The word of God for the people of God. Jesus enters into Jerusalem through Bethpage. In times past, the city of Bethpage was, before Jerusalem was a holy city, was where the people, the victims that were to be sacrificed, were kept. They were kept outside of Jerusalem, those that would be sacrificed on the altars or in the arenas or different things. This is where they were housed at or kept up at until the time for the sacrifice. So it was significant that Jesus would come in from Bethpage for sacrificial bishop victims were kept in times past and entered in Jerusalem. Having said this morning, what I want to really clue on to you, what I really want to ask you this morning and look at is when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this? Who is this?" Do all of you here this morning really know who he is? Do you really know who Jesus is? The disciples, those that were close to him, I mean close to him, walked with him, ate with him, slept with him, talked with him over a year. They thought they knew him. They thought he was the next physical king of Israel. They thought he was going to overthrow Rome. How many of us did they pray for us to overthrow the government from time to time? That's what they thought. I mean, this is what this man has come to do. He's come to overthrow Rome. Why, he's going to replace that physical king, Herod, and we're going to have a true king. We're going to have a new empire, new leaders. We're going to be heroes. If you look back at Matthew 20, 20 through 22, just prior to Jesus coming in Jerusalem, the mother of Zebedee's sons came to Jesus with her sons kneeling down and asked him a favor. What did she want? What is it you want? He asked. She said, "Grant that one of these two sons of mine may sit one on the right hand of your throne and one on the left, so that they can help you rule this new empire that you're going to build when we overthrow Rome, when we overthrow the government, when we get what we want to eat, when we get the housing, when we get prosperity." Nothing about salvation or eternal life. No thought of it. The here and now. They thought he was the next physical king. They have no clue. They have no clue as to the cup that they would be required to drink from. But yet Jesus asked him, said, "Do you know what you're asking?" Can you drink of the cup that I'm going to drink? We can, they answered. They don't, do they? Run and hide. They have no clue. Just who this morning do you think Jesus is? Think about it in a minute. I want you to really think. Who do you think Jesus is? Better yet, what do you really want him to do? What do you really want with and of this man called Jesus? In time, every one of his disciples save one would be able to suffer the death that he suffered. Jesus asked him, can you go through what I'm going through? They will suffer a martyrdom's death, and they will stand with him. But for the moment, they did not know, they did not understand who Jesus was and is. Even after living and walking with him on a daily basis, how long have you walked with Jesus? Do you really truly understand who he is? I catch myself sometimes praying for things. Whoa. That's not what I need to be praying for. Because it's a physical prayer. It's a physical prayer. It's like the disciples. It's a government prayer. It's an earthly prayer. Do you understand who Jesus is and what it is we are to ask and seek of him? At that moment in time, the disciples had no idea who Jesus was or is. After living and walking with him on a daily basis for a year, how many years have you been to church, Sunday school? Do you understand who Jesus, do you really understand who Jesus is? Do you recognize him? Is he what you expect? For most people, a lot of people today, the answer is still no. They don't recognize. They don't know Jesus. There are a lot of people today in churches, I believe, scattered across this country that they don't know Jesus. They don't know who he is. Thus, he does not know them. Because if you don't know who he is, then he doesn't know you. For most people, the answer is no. They don't know who he is. They don't know him. And thus, he does not know them. Peter the Rock. Peter, the one he called the Rock. I will never desert you. I will never deny you. I will fight to the death. Peter carried a sword, by the way. Peter was armed. one other disciple was armed. Two of them were armed. Peter was a fisherman. He probably used a sword for nets, fishing on a boat for different things, but he carried a sword. Probably about so long. Peter was armed. But when they came to arrest Jesus, I don't know where it was, Peter, one of them takes that knife that one of the two has and whoosh, off comes an ear. I mean, you think about that. That's close. And the Lord picks it up and it's as if it's never been cut off. The disciples still don't know who he is. What do? They run. They run. They go hide. They're confused. They're scared. Peter will follow at a distance, and later on, how many times have you been off somewhere and or in a crowd and they're talking jokes or stuff that they shouldn't be talking about, do you step in and say, you know, the Lord don't want to hear you talk like that? Or how many times are you sort of like Peter in your actions, if not your words? I don't know the man. I don't know him. I tell you, I don't know him. He doesn't know him. He's honest. But that's not what Peter thinks he is. The disciples thought at this time that 10,000 angels were going to appear. Literally. That not only are we going to raise an earthly army, but Jesus is going to have all this crowd that was out here on Palm Sunday, they all going to come out with whatever they got, and we're going to kick these Romans out. Who is this man that we follow? When things are easy, going our way, it's easy to be a Christian. It's easy to be a Christian. Let your car motor blow up in the parking lot when you go out there, crank it after service, and not quite as easy, is it, for some of us to be a Christian? I mean, why in the world did you let this happen to me, Lord? Might have saved you from a wreck down the road. Did you ever stop to think about that? But why? The crowd in Jerusalem, as Jesus came into Jerusalem that day, we like to think that we're part of that crowd sometimes in churches, and we wave the palm branches. Some churches do that on Palm Sunday, and they think this is a great thing. We're part of that crowd, man. They estimated somewhere between 100 and 200,000 people. It's quite a crowd. They cheered this itinerant preacher. They didn't know who he was. They didn't know Jesus. Who are they cheering? You know, if you go to Farmville all at once, let's say you go to Farmville next Saturday and there's a crowd gathered and you go down there and all at once they start hollering and cheering and running to the other end of town and calling, hey, how are you ready? Are you going to join in that crowd and follow them? This is what happened. This is what happened on Palm Sunday. A virtually unknown person, part of them have never heard of him, never seen him. Most of them never heard of him, never seen him. This unknown person shows up riding on a donkey, not on a white stallion like a king normally would do in Rome. Shows up riding on a donkey, and they start shouting, here's the promised Messiah, Hosanna, Hosanna, meaning Messiah, the promised Savior. Crowd goes wild. They gather together and they wave those palm branches at the man on the donkey. They don't know Jesus. They have no idea who this man is. They know nothing about him. All they want is what I want. And that's the yoke of Rome thrown off. I want to quit paying Roman taxes. I want the Romans out of here. I don't want no more Roman guards or no tax collectors for money. This is what they know. They don't know Jesus. They have no idea who this man is. An unknown person riding on a donkey. Messiah means promised my Savior. Savior from what? Savior from Rome. You ever prayed, Lord, save me from this world or from this government or from the taxes or from the debt I owe or from the... How many times we pray for worldly things? I'm guilty. And if you're not guilty, then God bless you and I don't believe you. The Lord knows what I need. He knows what you need before you ask. You need to praise his holy name and seek mercy and forgiveness, waving palm branches. You know, people have a habit, don't we, of blindly following some leader. Don't really know them. Presidents, we run out, and I don't care who you voted for. I'm not talking about anyone. But we run out and gather crowds all around them and shout and holler, we want him. We have no idea on either side who really either are. Because you don't know their inner beings. You don't know their inner thoughts. You don't know their heart's desires. All you know is their outer shell. You could say that Palm Sunday was an unexplained phenomenon, really. The disciples perhaps see this as a sign as he's an earthly king that they desire. I want you to think this morning, what really happened on Palm Sunday, and where are you individually? Where are you in your walk with Jesus? I hope you're beyond Palm Sunday. It's nice to want to be part of the crowd and waving the branches, but are you waving them because you know who he is? Who he really is? He's the King of eternity. He's more interested in your eternal soul. That's his main interest. And where are you going to spend eternity? He knows you need all these other things. Doesn't the Bible say? So you heaven. He knows you need the rain and the sun and enough money to buy food. He knows you need all these things before you ask. You can ask him. That's all right. But understand who he really is. What's really important. And it's not the external, it's the internal. Where are you in your walk with Jesus this morning? Are we one of the disciples looking for personal, worldly gain? Is that why we are here? It's estimated that 2.5 million people were in and around Jerusalem during the Passover. You've got to keep in mind, people from all over the known world, not just Jews, now have come into Jerusalem. Rome's nervous. I mean, if you want to raise an army now, and you got the charisma, now's the time. And if one's looking like he can raise the army, then they got their eyes on him. I mean, the Jews have been known to come out of nowhere and fight before. So out of that 2.5 million, if that's roughly what it is, you can bet several hundred thousand of them were Roman soldiers. They everywhere you look. The crowds are enthusiastic. You know, as politicians would say, they're enthusiastic. But their support is broad, but it's shallow. Just like when they run for president. They have broad support, but most of it's shallow. How many of them turn on them within the first few weeks or months? I wish I'd never voted for that person. But we don't really know, do we? We don't know these individuals. They didn't know Jesus. But do you know him? Do you really know him? Is this just Palm Sunday for you? With the crowd? Easter Sunday is coming up, when the ladies used to wear their hats and the orchids, and that's long since gone. And I think a lot of them maybe came off to show their new dresses and their hats and the men their new suits. I mean, you see them on Easter, and then you might see them at Christmas and Thanksgiving, and then might not see them no more to the next one. The crowds are enthusiastic, just as the politicians. The power structure, the temple religious leaders, though, now, Look at the government. This is where they're looking at it. The ones in power, they're nervous. As Trump got closer to, I'm not pushing, but as he got closer to winning, what happened? The other side got real nervous, didn't they? We're going to lose this thing. Well, the temple leaders, the priests, the preachers, the churches are, they're nervous. What's this itinerant preacher here? Billy Graham's coming to town. There won't be nobody in church Sunday. We just will call it off. And he's a great preacher, probably a very good man. The crowds were not really hollering hooray for Jesus. More than likely, the crowds in Jerusalem, the bulk of them, were using this for a political stand. I mean, this is a time to say something to Rome with the right leader. And they will revolt. Jerusalem will revolt. Remember, in 70 AD, Jesus predicts it. Jerusalem does rise up and gives Rome a run for its money. So Jesus is being watched, both by the Romans and by the Jewish elite. He knows it. Jesus' mood's not a victorious one. How does Jesus enter Jerusalem? How does he go to the temple? It's confrontational, isn't it? He leaves there and goes into the temple. What is he doing to that church? That's where he's at, is in their church. He takes a whip and cleans house. Yeah. Who is this man called Jesus of Nazareth? He wept. Why do you think Jesus cried when he came up on Jerusalem and looked down on it? You think he cried for the Roman enslavement? Or perhaps he cried for their ignorance, their lack of recognizing who the Messiah was and what he come for. Not for political reasons. Not so that the Jewish people would have more money and easier life or rule themselves. He didn't come to free him from the state of Rome. He could have done that. He came to die that we could have eternal life. He came for what is important. I mean, we think this is important. Life is important down here, and I want to live as long as I can, but what's more important is where I'm going to spend eternity. And to get there, you've got to know who Jesus is. Really is. Jesus presented himself as a king, but not the kind of king that the world knows. He would wield no political power, but he would fulfill precisely the predictions made about him in Isaiah 53. I am the Lord, your Holy One, Israel's Creator, your King. I am the Lord, the Holy One, your Creator, one who created you, your King. Jesus entered Jerusalem with many, including the disciples, saying, really and truly, who is this man? They're confused. If you could choose this morning, who would you most likely spend a day with? Many have said Jesus. Many other people hate or try to ignore him. Bill Bucknight, preacher, said, "Think of it. No pagan, secular script writer can produce a manuscript in today's movie industry without including the name of Jesus somewhere. People either worship him or curse him, but it seems that no one can ignore him. He could be gentle, kind, loving. He could burn with anger toward cold-hearted legalists. Jesus had an inexuberant patience with individuals, but no patience at all with the institutions or injustice." Truly, I believe Jesus is misunderstood today by most people, just as he was misunderstood when he entered into Jerusalem. They don't really understand who Jesus really is, what he really came for, and what he can really do for you, what's really important. In fact, most of us, a lot of times, really don't understand what's important to us. We get wrapped up when we're younger and making a living, making a job, getting promotions, this, that, and the other. Jerusalem thought he was a prophet and nothing more. When asked who he was, why John the Baptist reincarnated, Elijah come back from the tomb. Matthew 16, 13, and 14. People then and now have a hard time getting a fix on who Jesus really is. If you go back to the 60s, they tried to turn him into a hippie, long hair and the whole nine yards. Those of us that lived through the 60s. Do you know Jesus was not crucified saying, "Let the little children come unto me"? He was assaulted by the money changers. He assaulted the money changers in the temple. Called them crooks. He run them out. This was the religious people. Jesus was courageous. He was bigger than any political agenda. Each one of us, in the privacy of our own hearts and lives this morning, and every morning, every day of your life, when you get up, you have to make a decision. I believe this. I believe it has to be done every day, personally. Every day when you get up, you have to decide who Jesus is. Jesus is either who he said he was, the Son of God, or either he's a madman or a liar. Every day that you rise up and open your eyes, you have to decide for this day, who is this man called Jesus? Either you're going to make him the king of your life, the king of your heart, either you're going to let him rule your life, guide your life, lead you. Or you're not going to know him. Because you can't know him if you don't invite him to come into your heart and your life and take over and take charge. And then let him. Each of us in the privacy of our own hearts and own souls must decide, who is this man called Jesus? Remember after the parade, Jesus asked a question. But who do you say that I am? Church, this morning, who do you say that he is? Who do you say this man Jesus is? If you say who he is and you really mean it, you know what? He may change your values. He may change your habits. He can change your priorities, your spending patterns, your friends, your vocation. He'll make changes. Now, you might think it's just more safer to stand by the road and cheer. But those standing by the road and cheering one day are going to wake up in hell. Those waving the palm branches one day are going to end up in hell if they don't come to the realization, if they do not come to the realization of who he is. See, when you say Jesus is Lord, then you've revealed the essential you. When you truly say Jesus is Lord of my life, he's the Lord for me. He's going to reign. He's going to reign in my life. He's going to run my life for me. Maybe this morning Jesus has walked the streets of your life for a long time. He may be seeking a heart to rule, and a soul to save, a life to transform. Keep this one thing in mind, whatever you think he is or whoever you think he is, I'm here to tell you that one day he will judge you and me. So if you don't know Jesus this morning, who he really is, take time to crown him King and King and Lord of your heart, your soul. Amen. Take our hymnals this morning. The altar's open as we turn to page number number 297. Beneath the Cross. Would you dismiss us?
Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for the message that we have heard. And Lord, I pray that each and every one of us, including myself, that we would really know who Jesus is, and that he lived within our hearts. And Lord, as we think upon Sunday, how the people shouted and said, Hosanna, and yet the next week they crucified him. They had no idea who he was. Lord, I thank you today that we can know who you are. And you can live within our hearts. Be with us now as we go to our homes. Be with us this evening as we come back as we start revival, Lord. And I pray you would revive our hearts and give us the strength as we go out to tell others. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.